Welcome to the part 3 of chapter 8, that is controlling. In the last session, we saw what are the controlling processes. Now, let's study what are the techniques of controlling. When we talk about techniques, there are two techniques of controlling. We have traditional technique and we have modern technique. So first, let's understand that what are the traditional techniques of managerial control. Traditional techniques are those which have been used by the companies for a longer time now. And however, even though these techniques have not become obsolete, and they are still being used by many of the companies. And these techniques would include personal observation, statistical report, break-even analysis, and budgetary control. So these are the traditional techniques of controlling. Among that, let's learn one by one. First is personal observation. The name itself suggests that this is the most traditional method of controlling, wherein the personal observation is being undertaken. So it enables the manager to collect the first-hand information. Now, this personal observation, it also creates a psychological pressure because employee is, you know, well much aware that he's being observed continuously or he's being monitored so that his performance could be judged. So it creates a psychological pressure on the employees to perform, as well as they are aware that they are being observed personally on their job. Now, this process is very time consuming and control cannot effectively be used in all kinds of jobs because personal observation is not possible if your organization is large, because it would require not only time, but also the human efforts. The second technique is statistical report. Now, statistical analysis in the form of average, percentage, ratio, correlation, etc., present useful information to the managers regarding the performance. So manager can just look into the statistical report, either a chart or a graph or a table, and just make out from that chart or table as to what has been the performance of every individual. So this will help the manager to read overall report of that particular activity, which would save his time and efforts. The third method is break-even analysis. First, we need to understand that what is break-even point. Break-even point is the point where there is no profit, no loss. So break-even analysis is the technique which is used by managers to study the relationship between the cost and the volume and the profit. So it will help you to determine the probable profit and loss at different level of activity. Now that break-even analysis chart or graph will help you that how much amount or how much volume has to be produced at what cost so that the company can earn profit. So the sales volume at which there is no profit or no loss, that is your break-even point. This is one of the very useful technique for manager because it helps in estimating the profit at different level of every activity. We can see this formula that break-even point is equal to fixed cost upon selling price per unit minus variable cost. Now, this break-even analysis will help the firm in keeping a close check over its variable cost. So if there are any variations, then appropriate preventive measures or actions can be taken to correct that activity. We can see this in this chart, the point where there is break-even point, that is the sales volume is 50,000 units. So when the company is producing 50,000 units at particular cost, which is shown on the left-hand side, then it is a break-even point where there is no profit, no loss. If the company goes beyond break-even point, only then they will start earning profit. And which means if they want to earn profit, they have to go beyond the break-even point, which obviously means they'll have to increase their sales and by reducing the cost. If they go below the break-even point, that would incur a loss to the firm. So a company has to take care of all the variables, cost, the fixed cost, and take preventive actions, or if there are any deviations, they have to take corrective action. The next is budgetary control. Now, budgetary control is a technique of managerial control in which all the operations, all the activities are planned in advance. Like, let's say, for example, we have various departments. We have sales department, we have purchase, we have finance. So for every department, a budget is being set. Like, let's say we have a sales budget. In that, it is mentioned that how much amount of sales target is to be achieved. Marketing would set that how much investment has to be done on advertising. Finance would set a budget as to how much investment has to be done on the production, or how much investment has to be made in the various areas in order to achieve the objective. So this way, different budgets are set for different departments. So budget is a quantitative statement for a definite future period of time for the purpose of obtaining a given objective. Now, it is also a statement which would reflect the policy of that particular period. As I gave you the example, we can see over here the various types of budget, like material budget, a statement of estimated quantity and cost of materials required for production. R&D, that is research and development budget, that is how much estimated spending should be done, or how much investment should be done for particular R&D, research and development, about for the improving the product or making the product better. So these are the various types of budget in budgetary control. So the effectiveness of budgeting depends on how accurately the estimates have been made about the future. So manager must remember that budgeting should not be viewed as an end, but it is a means to achieve our organizational objectives. Now, these are the traditional techniques. Now, let's understand what are the advantages of budgeting. Budgeting obviously focuses on specific and time-bound targets. So it will help in achieving the organizational objective. Now, when we set a budget for every department or for every employee, then it is a source of motivation, because the employee knows the performance standard as to what he or she is expected to do. And when you are clear with the instruction, when the directing is clear, then it will help you to have maximum or optimum utilization of resources, because we have been given the budget and we have to work within that frame standard. So that would help us to have optimum utilization of resources. Budgeting is also used for achieving the coordination among the different departments. Like, as I had mentioned also earlier, that when we have different departments, now marketing department cannot function without knowing as to how much production is going to be taken place this year. Production again is decided on the basis of demand of the consumers, and that information is provided by the marketing department. So marketing department would actually inform the production department that how much amount or volume of sales could be done or is expected in this year, and accordingly production is being done. So this way all the departments are interrelated, they coordinate with each other in order to accomplish the task. So budgeting, it facilitates the management by exception also, because you are stressing on those operations which are, likely to be deviated from the budgeted standard. Now let's study about the modern techniques. Modern techniques of controlling are the ones which are of the recent origin, and they are comparatively new in the management literature. Now this would include return on investment, ratio analysis, PERT, CPM, responsibility accounting, management audit, and MIS, that is management information system. What is return on investment? When we hear it in simple terms, it means that, whatever we are investing, obviously we would expect something in return. And your investment, if your investment is more, and return on that investment is less, then your company is facing loss. So any organization would expect that whatever they are investing into the business, in terms of human resources, in terms of capital, the return should be more than the investment. So return on investment is a useful technique which provides a basic yardstick for measuring whether or not invested capital has been used effectively or not. And the formula for calculating return on investment is net income before interest and tax upon capital employed. Now, rate of interest can be increased either by increasing the sales volume. That is, if you want more outcome or more return on investment, you will either have to increase your sales volume or reduce the cost of production. So either of it will give you the benefit. So return on investment provides top management an effective means of control for measuring and comparing the actual performance with the standard performance in the various departments. It will also help and permit the departmental manager to find out the problem which affects the return on investment in adverse manner. Now, if let's say, for example, if marketing team, they have invested about more than 1 crore or let's say 1 crore in marketing a product, obviously the return should be more. If the return is not more than 1 crore, then it's going to be a huge loss to the company. So a manager has to continuously monitor as to they are getting the return on their investment or not. The next modern technique is ratio analysis. That is, it refers to analysis of the financial statements through computation of ratio. And the most commonly used ratios used by all the organizations are liquidity ratio, which means they are calculated to determine the short-term solvency of the business. Now, analysis of these current position of liquid funds determine the ability of the business to pay the amount due to stakeholders. Your liquidity ratio, if your liquidity ratio is more, which means that you would be able to pay back to your stakeholders. The next is solvency ratio. Ratio which are calculated to determine the long-term solvency of business. That is, these ratio actually help you to find out the ability of the business to service its indebtedness. Like, let's say, for example, if the company is under too much of debt, which means that their solvency ratio is very less. In certain cases, the business don't survive because their amount of debt increases towards the stakeholders. Next is profitability ratio. These are the very common one which we are hearing. These ratios are calculated to analyze that what is the profitability position of an organization. So such ratio will involve analysis of profit in relation to sales. Turnover ratios are again calculated to determine the efficiency of operation, whether it helps you to, you know that all the activities which are carried on, are they based on the effective utilization or not. When we say that turnover ratio are high or high turnover, which means that you have utilized all your resources very well. So every organization aims to have more turnover ratio, because every organization wants to make best utilization of all the resources which are available to them, be it human resource, be it physical resource, be it capital resources. Next is responsibility accounting. Now, responsibility accounting is a system of accounting in which different sections or divisions or departments, be it HR department, finance, or under that if there are any divisions, all these divisions and departments of the organization are set up as a responsibility center. And the head of this center is responsible for achieving the target. Like, let's say, for example, we have a cost center. So a cost or expense center is a segment of organization wherein the manager are held responsible for the cost which is incurred, which means If the cost is incurred, it is the responsibility of the manager. He is accountable or answerable. Whereas he is not accountable for the revenue. Nobody, you know, all the costs which are made, he is responsible for that. So such cost center manager will always try to reduce the cost of production through various means and ways. Second one is revenue center. Revenue means income. So revenue center is a segment of any organization which whose responsibility is to generate revenue. We can take example as marketing. The main aim of marketing or having marketing department is to generate revenue. Next, we can have profit center. Now, when an organization can earn profit? Two, either you increase your sales volume. Two, either you reduce the cost of production. And how you can reduce the cost of production? By continuously monitoring all the fixed assets. That is having a proper repair and maintenance department who monitors any deviations, or, you know, so that no accidents take place. So a profit center is a segment of organization whose manager is responsible for both revenue generation and cost. As I said, that example is repair and maintenance department of organization. You know, it may be treated as a profit center. The next one is investment center. And investment center is responsible not only for profit, but also for investment made in the center in the form of assets. We have, you know, any company, they make so much of investment in the into the assets, like getting new machineries, new technologically advanced machines, tools, equipment. So all these are the investment centers. And the investment made in each center is separately ascertained, and return on that investment is used as a basis for judging the performance. Like, let's say, for example, if any company has brought new technology, you know, technically advanced machine. Now, when you have made an investment to, you know, implement a new machine so that production could be better, obviously the company would expect that with this new asset, the return is more. So it is the responsibility of the manager over years to keep a check that with this investment, there is more return on that. Next is management audit. Management audit refers to systematic appraisal of the overall performance of management of organization. So the purpose is to check whether all the tasks have been performed efficiently and effectively or not. And if there are any deviations, then action has to be taken so that you meet all the objectives which are, you know, to be fulfilled. It also helps you in identifying any deficiency in the performance. As I said, that when management audit is done, it is especially the purpose is to keep a check that every activity, every operation is performed effectively and efficiently. So management audit may be defined as an evaluation of the functioning of performance, that every performance or every function is being checked at every level. So conducting this management audit, it of course sometimes, you know, it may pose a problem because there are no standard techniques of management audit. What are the advantages of this management audit? It helps to locate present and potential deficiency in the performance. That is, it helps you to compare your actual performance with the standard performance and continuously monitor the performance of every function of the management. And it, of course, helps you to have a coordination between the different departments, because no organization can work smoothly without coordination between the different departments. The next technique is PERT and CPM. PERT means Program Evaluation and Review Technique, and CPM means Critical Path Method. Now, these are the important network techniques which are useful in planning and controlling. these techniques are specially useful for planning purpose. When you know, when your production process is long, or when the production process is more, then you, through PERT and CPM, you can derive at the shortest route or path, which does not, you know, which consumes less time, or which provides you the easiest way or mode of working. Now, these techniques deal with time scheduling and resource allocation for these activities and aims at effective execution of the project. So what are the steps in PERT and CPM? Let's understand this. Let's say, for example, if there is a project, there is a manufacturing company, a garment manufacturing company. Now, obviously, we have certain process of production. Let's say first they get the raw materials, they cut those raw materials or the, you know, piece of clothes into the shape of shirts, and then it is converted, stitching, and so on. So by the time it comes out as a finished product, it has to pass through the various process or various stages. So the project, let's say, it's divided into number of clearly identifiable activities, which are then arranged in logical sequence. Now, after dividing your project and after arranging into the logical sequence, a network diagram is prepared to show the sequence of these activities. And in this sequence, even the time or the time taken for this project is mentioned right from the starting point till the end point. Like, let's say, for example, how much time is consumed in the raw material area, how much time is consumed for converting the cloth into the, you know, taking the shape of the shirt. Then in the next step, it is mentioned that how much time is being taken for converting that, you know, cutting and then stitching. So this way, a network diagram is prepared to show the sequence of activities right from the starting point and the termination point of the project. So time estimates are prepared for each activity, and PERT requires the preparation of three time estimates. That is the shortest time, the longest time, and the most appropriate time. So in addition, CPM also requires making cost estimates for the completion of the project, that even cost is being estimated at each level of the activity. So obviously, with this, you will only choose to go through the process which is the shortest and which is cost effective. Longest path in the network is identified as a critical path, and it represents the sequence of those activities which are important for timely completion. And if there are any deviation, then the things can be calculated that which process is taking more time, which is one of the cause for delay. So we can say that if you know, if required, the plan can be modified so that execution and the project is completed on time. Another modern technique is MIS, that is Management Information System. It is a computer-based information system wherein it provides information to the manager with regard to all the activities which are being undertaken. And it is very helpful for the, you know, managerial people, because it helps them to take the decision. A decision maker, of course, would require updated information, accurate information, and timely information. And he gets all these things with the help of MIS, because Management Information System, it provides the required information to the managers in systematic order. So by providing this systematically, you know, arranged information, it will become easier for manager to just spend time on the focused areas. So MIS is important communication tool for managers, because it gives the manager all the information by systematically processing a huge data which is generated in the organization. Now, what are the advantages of MIS? It facilitates collection, management, and dissemination of information at different levels, which means at all the different level of activity or operations in the organization, everything is systematically recorded and reported. So it supports planning and decision making, because it would be easy for manager to take the decision as to what activities are still pending, what activities has to be performed, and how they have to take various measures to achieve the goal of the organization. It will also help to improve the quality of information with which a manager works, and it ensures cost effectiveness in managing all the information which we have. I hope you have understood the various techniques of controlling. Thank you very much.